Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Ruchi Jha, who is the director and co-founder at iMithila Handicrafts and Handloom Private Limited, who would be sharing her insights. So Ruchi, over to you.
iMithila, India's first brand in any folk art form. iMithila specializes in Madhubani hand-painted products, innovative products as well. I was an investment banker by profession when I started iMithila in the year 2016. So a lot of people ask me that, okay, you are an investment banker, why did you quit your job and start such kind of thing? So the answer was, as an investment banker, I was not content with what I was doing. Unfortunately, I happened to visit my native during that time. I'm from Bihar and Madhubani art form is a native to me. Although I never had this privilege of having this infrastructure available, unlike few of my colleagues who happen to have this art form practiced at their home. Still, when I happened to visit my native place, I happened to meet a lot of artisans. A few of them were national awardees, few of them were state awardees. And I saw this art form painted on each of the households. It's still being done in few of the households in rural Bihar. So when I met these tier 2 artisans, or the artisans whose names were not very well recognized, unlike the state awardees or the national awardees. So what happens in this art form is the national and state awardees products or paintings sell like hotcakes, you know. So somebody wants to buy a Madhubani painting, he or she says that, okay, I want to buy a product of, say, a Bharti Dayal's painting or Mahasundari Devi's painting or Lova Devi's painting. So they sell on the name. But for the tier 2 artisans, whose work is exemplary, people have been practicing this for generations, they're still not able to make a livelihood out of this art form. Of the products which they are making. So, there lies a huge problem. And a couple of more challenges I saw. First question came into my head was, since this art form is so old, it found its first mention in the time of Ramayana. Sita ji was from this region, Mithila. And when she got married to Lord Ram, the entire city of Mithila was painted with this art form using natural products like cow dung or turmeric or these kind of things. So this art form found its first mention centuries back, and it could have been happening before that also. So that intrigued me, and each painting has a story to tell. So there is nothing abstract in this art form. Everything has a storyline behind it. Everything has thinking behind it. And I'll share one very interesting thing that in this art form, there is a lot of logic and science also applied behind it. So if I take an example of a kobar, which is like which is something which is put in every Mithila household when a marriage is taking place. So there is a lot of logic and perspective behind these paintings, which this painting specifically represents good luck and good luck to the new couple. So I felt that this heritage and culture needs to be preserved. If we don't do that, then people like me who did not even know about the thinking and the logic behind this art form, me and my next generation, we are never going to know what kind of culture we belong to. Second thing was, if you're not able to provide a platform to the tier 2 artisans for showcasing their work, migration happens. People are going to leave practicing the art form and they're going to migrate to other cities just the way they have been doing for getting a job. So these kind of things were there, which came into my head, and I felt that it is such a nice thing, and it is such a vibrant painting or art form. It needs to have a global platform. So why till now it hasn't been done? So couple of issues I saw there. Now people would ask me easily that, okay, fine, you were not the one who knew the painting, you were not the one who was making the product. Then why do you think that you were the most suitable one to put this art form and start iRecycle? So there also I could see a couple of challenges and issues. What happens is an artisan is in love with the art form or the product he's making. So he or she is not able to understand what the end consumer wants, what the end consumer wants in terms of pricing, what the end consumer wants in terms of a product. What should be the go-to market strategy for that? How you're going to deliver the product? A lot of things are in question, and a lot of perspective has to be put into this entire issue. So when I looked into such kind of things, and since I'm an engineer and an MBA in finance with some corporate exposure, I felt that I was able to fit into this gap between the artisan as well as the direct market and the consumer. Now, traditionally, as I said, the artisan is in love with the product. Earlier, only saris or paintings were being produced. So I had a feeling that suppose I am an artisan, and if I want to buy something, I will buy something for my mother. I will want to buy a sari, and my transaction with that artisan or with that brand ends over there only. So in order to keep the transactions happening and in order to make the product more sellable, we needed to expand into more innovative product lines, say suppose a tray or maybe suppose a poster or something which excited the consumer as also. And the consumer had to see the value of money which he will be putting into the product. So if I am asking somebody to pay suppose 2,000 or 3,000 rupees, and the customer is not seeing any value in that product except of that product being a masterpiece and an art form, I don't think anybody would want to spend that much of money. So these were the issues. Now, the artisan, nowadays what is happening is since we are talking a lot about vocal for local, the Prime Minister has been talking about reaching a 5 trillion economy dream. We are talking about putting more emphasis on Make in India products and putting a lot of emphasis in manufacturing. This entire handloom and handicraft industry, which is the second largest employer of the country, giving almost 66% of the employability to women, most of them coming from bottom of the pyramid. I think this is solving a lot of problems. You know, in terms of financial inclusion, digital literacy. So this sector cannot be left behind. You need to put a lot of emphasis on this sector, and you need to first of all understand how are you going to bridge the gap between the artisan and the end customer. So in order to bridge this gap, government has also been doing a lot. With the help of, say, Amazon or a Flipkart, they're trying to directly put the products on these platforms by the artisans, which is a great thing. But I feel there is still a lot of problems which are going to happen because the artisan does not understand the algorithm behind these e-commerce platforms, no marketplaces, how the products are going to look like on the marketplace. What is the price point which the customer is looking for on the platform? Counterfeiting is again a big challenge on e-commerce platforms. So a similar kind of product which the artisan is already selling. So more than 10 crore products are there on the marketplace. How the artisan is going to differentiate himself and tell the customer, okay, please come and search for my products and buy them. So these are the challenges still that the artisan is facing, still the artisan is going to face. So somebody has to handhold them and tell them, okay, see, this is not working, and this is how it should be done, so that you are able to sell your product and you are able to make a livelihood out of that thing. What we did at iRecycle was, we since I had some experience with corporate. I established a brand name, a brand identity for this art form. So suppose now if a customer is, if somebody is telling, asking his friend that, okay, I where did you buy this kurti material from and or kurti from, and the person says, okay, I bought from iMithila. So that person could easily establish the fact that iMithila is a brand which stands for specifically Madhubani and painted products, which was not happening before since the sector was unorganized and since there was no nobody actually put a thought into giving this art form a brand name or a voice. So these kind of things we did differently from the unorganized players or the people who were doing business before us. Now I see technology to play. I have been seeing, and when we started in 2016, we had our own website as well as we were present on different marketplaces. So the idea of having our own website was to have our brand identity and brand recall also. A lot of big players, a lot of big brands are now getting on to direct to consumers, acquiring their customers directly, having their own website, having the direct access to the customers, eliminating the middlemen, eliminating the margins and everything, so that they can have a better database of customers and they can have a direct communication with the customers also. So we did this way back in 2016 so that we could directly speak to the customers, understand what they are looking for, and we could manage things and we could understand their demands and what they want from us directly, which has been happening now. Going forward also, I see e-commerce to be a very important part of our lives. Now, it has become so convenient that you want to have a product, you like something, it has become so easy for you to just order it, and availability of these products has also become very easy nowadays. So something which I was not able to buy sitting in a tier 2 or tier 3 city sometime back, maybe 2 or 3 years back, now I can have the same product, same brand, international brand also sitting in the convenience of my home. So that is something which e-commerce has given us and which has made our life very easier. So I don't see e-commerce going anywhere anytime soon. I see a lot of consolidation happening in the coming years. Big players are going to stay since in e-commerce, especially marketplaces, a lot of cash burn happens. You just keep burning cash. So if you are a big player, you can afford to do that. But if you are a small one, you will be thrown out of your game in no time. So just be careful about that. And I also see AI playing an important role in e-commerce in giving the customers first-hand experience, usage experience. Nowadays, they ask you on the website, they ask you to just put your picture and they will tell you how the product is going to look on you based on your picture itself. So that is something, again, which is going to give a lot of confidence as well as convenience to the customer. Second thing, I feel that AI is again going to play an important role in demand forecasting. It is going to play a very important role in understanding what the customer is looking for, what price point the customer is looking for. In case you are leaving the website, you like the product, but you don't like the price, real time, it will give you a discount coupon and it will ask you to just stay there and buy the product. So yes, I think without technology, I don't think e-commerce or any business for that matter is going to sustain. Even in brick and mortar, if you see, AI is being used and the data collection of customers is being used in order to gauge the demand, in order to what the customer is looking for exactly, and then in order to reach out to the customer directly. So technology and any sector you are talking about, agri tech, retail tech, you're talking about e-commerce, you talk about handloom and handicraft. It's how well you are able to combine these two in order to give the customers a better experience in order to bridge the gap between any industry and the end consumer. I think I'm done here. I would like to thank NASSCOM for giving me an opportunity to be here today and speak about my experience and speak about what the future is going to be like for us. I would request all of you to visit iNitsila. That's our website would be iNitsila.com and iNitsila is a brand. Do check us out and please, I would request all of you to go for Vocal for Local and please use local products, please use Make in India products and please give this dream of 5 trillion economy a boost. Thank you.
Ruchi, first of all, congratulations for what you're doing and thanks a lot for joining us here at NASSTECH 2021 and sharing your experiences.